Good morning. Y'all look lovely today. Why don't you stand? And here's the instructions for the morning. Go ahead and stand. I'm going to have an opening word of prayer. And this is your welcome. And then following that, the children are going to sing. And I'm going to ask you to sit after I have prayer. And after that, Taylor has some announcements. So after I get done praying, just have a seat and you'll figure out the rest of it, okay? So, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you that we are in the midst of VBS. We're excited about the week, and I pray that you bless the teachers, the helpers, those that decorating, those in the kitchen, everybody that's participating, and the students as we get to teach. Father, thank you and help us to shine Jesus this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
As you can see, we're super excited that Stellar VBS starts tomorrow, and the kids really enjoyed going through this spaceship. I'm sure you guys did too, right? I do have a few announcements, of course. VBS starts tomorrow, if you didn't know, at 9 a.m. If you have not registered or if you know someone that you know is coming, like a neighbor or a friend, it is very, very helpful for us to have them go ahead and register before tomorrow so that we have all their crews done and everything is assigned and we don't have to wait in long lines tomorrow. So there's a QR code right as you're leaving still with a sign that has that information. If anyone is available to decorate, today we're going to be here from about 1 to 5. Of course, the stage is all decorated, but we also need to get the classrooms ready that we couldn't really do until after church today. So if you could help with that, that would be great. Any crew leaders or station leaders, if you could be here by 9:40 tomorrow. We already have 140 kids registered, which is great. We're super excited about that. But of course, we need as many people here early as possible so that we can have our crew leaders already in the pews before everyone gets here so we know where we're going. T-shirts, if anyone still would like a t-shirt that didn't order one, I have a few extras in different sizes. If you can just find me and toward my office at the end of church, I can get one of those. The closing program is Friday the 23rd at 6. We still need some people to help serve popcorn. Ted needs some help that day. We also need some people to help supervise the inflatables, which is everyone's favorite job. So if you could do either of those, please just let me know. The kitchen needs help on Thursday of this week, that morning, because we're going to be serving some fruit rockets. So if you have any extra time and you can't be here the whole week, but maybe you could just commit to Thursday morning, we need a few extra hands to prepare that snack from like 9 a.m. to 11 on Thursday. And then if you would like to help tear down the set, next Saturday at 10, we're all going to be here in the sanctuary. And of course, the more hands we have, the quicker it will get done. So I just want to say thank you to everybody for your support. Please be in prayer for the week, as we have a lot of kids coming, and we're just super excited to get to share the love of Jesus with them so that they can shine their light to other people in their lives. So I think that's all I've got. So thank you. Yes. Yeah, Jeanette. Yes. Oh, yeah, not 9:40. Definitely not 9:40. Whew, that would be really bad. Okay, 8:40, for sure 8:40. 9:40, we will already be at our first station, and I will be by myself with 140 kids. That would be really bad. Thank you. Okay, that's all.
Take a moment to meet and greet each other, if you would, please, and then the worship team will take over after that. So stand up, shake a hand, give a hug, do whatever you want to do, okay?
Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your. Just as you are to worship, come, just as you are before your God, come. One day every tongue will confess you are God, one day every knee will bow, still the greatest treasure remains for those who time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your just as you are, come.
Well, you've already meted and greeted, so just have a seat.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to Him I give, ever to Him I'll cling. In His blessed presence live, ever His praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to Him belongs. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by His love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea. Pillars His will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
This one's Colin's favorite this morning.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You lay down Your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations in truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You lay down Your life. That I would be set free. All that You've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You lay down. sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Bow down and the
seas will roar at the sound.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Father's Day to you, dads. We can begin this morning. There's a video I want to share with you. Ken Vaughn called this week, and he said, if you get a chance, watch this video. And so I did. It's Oklahoma University won a girls softball championship. And it's several of the girls being interviewed on ESPN. And I think you'll appreciate the testimony they give. And it goes really along well with the sermon, especially the topic today. So, Jerry, are we good with the video? Okay.
For the players, I know you talk. Alex Scarborough with ESPN. For the players, I know you talk about keeping the joy of the game. But I'm curious, it's a long season, right? And you guys have had the target on your back the entire time. The win streak being number one. How do you handle the unique pressure that comes with that? How do you keep the joy for so long when anxiety seems like a thing that can very easily set in?
Well, the only way that you can have a joy that doesn't fade away is from the Lord. And any other type of joy is actually happiness that comes from circumstances and outcomes. And I think Coach has said this before, but joy from the Lord is really the only thing that can keep you motivated, just in a good mindset, no matter the outcomes. Thankfully, we've had a lot of success this year, but if it was the other way around, joy from the Lord is the only thing that can keep you embracing those memories, moments, friendships, and all of that. So that's really the only answer to that, because there's no other way that softball can bring you that because of how much failure comes in it and just how much of a roller coaster the game can be.
1,000%. Agree with Grace Lyons. I went through that my freshman year. I was so happy to win the college. I've talked about this before, but I was just so happy that we won the College World Series, but I didn't feel joy. I didn't know what to do the next day. I didn't know what to do for that following week. I didn't feel filled, and I had to find Christ in that. And I think that is what makes our team so strong, is that we're not afraid to lose, because if it's not the end of the world if we do lose. Yes, obviously we've worked our butts off to be here and we want to win, but it's not the end of the world because our life is in Christ and that's all that matters.
Yeah, I think a huge thing that we've really just latched onto is eyes up. And you guys see us doing this and pointing up, but we're really like fixing our eyes on Christ. And that's something where, like we were saying, you can't find a fulfillment in an outcome, whether it's good or bad. And I think that's why we're so steady in what we do and our love for each other and our love for the game, because we know this game is giving us the opportunity to glorify God. Mm-hmm. And I just think once we figured that out and that was our purpose and everyone was all in with that, it's really changed so much for us. And I mean, I know myself, I've seen so much of a growth in myself with once I turned to Jesus and I realized how he had changed my outlook on life, not just softball, but understanding how much I have to live for, and that's living to exemplify the kingdom. And I think that brings so much freedom. And I'm sure everyone's story is similar, but we all have those great testimonies that have really like shown how awesome it is to play for something bigger. And I think that's just what brings me so much joy. And no matter the outcome, whether we get a trophy in the end or not, this isn't our home. And I think that's what's amazing about it is we have so much more. We have an eternity of joy with our Father, and I'm so excited about that. And yes, I live in the moment, but I know this isn't my home, and no matter what, my sisters in Christ will be there with me in the end when we're with our King. So,
Patty, you've got...
This isn't our home, is it? That's great. Okay, turn to Matthew chapter 5 this morning. That's going to be our main text. Matthew chapter 5, we're going to be in verse 14. This is the Sermon on the Mount. A lot of you are familiar with that text. Matthew chapter 5, just as 14 through 16. Let's pray as we start. Father God, thank you for the recognition, the glory those ladies gave you about what a stage and what a representative they were for your glory. I pray this morning, Father, as we study the scriptures and see how Jesus is the light of the world, and Father, we are to follow in that footpath, that you bless our lives. Thank you for today. Thank you for this coming week. Lord, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Matthew chapter 5, just as 14 through 16. Jesus speaking said, "You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father." You have figured out by now, it's VBS week. You can tell by the way we're dressed and a few things that we have on stage. I can't even stand up there. There's so much stuff. But this year's theme is stellar. Let Jesus shine. That's what the lessons are all about. And we're excited. We're going to have 150 plus kids in here every single day. And we look forward to sharing Jesus with them when we get a chance to. And you know as well as I do that letting Jesus shine in our lives is not always an easy thing. It's a learned process. It's like two little boys, oftentimes they were growing up in the home, and as everything happens in a home, these two little boys were in constant rivalry. They were a little bit young, and one morning, summertime, mom was getting up fixing breakfast, and as they ran into the kitchen, they fought over who would get the very first cup of juice that was sitting there on the counter, and they went back and forth. And then they went over, and somebody needed that special plate, and they fought about who would get the special plate, and then they ran over to the silverware drawer, and one of them wanted the Superman fork, and the other didn't get it, of course, and that went back and forth, and mom kind of got frustrated with them. She was preparing the pancakes and finished up the very first pancake, and before she put it on the plate, she says, "Boys, you know better than that." She said, "You know what Jesus taught us, and if Jesus were here right now, and I'm getting ready to feed you, what would Jesus do?" Well, the little boy said, "Well, Jesus would let the other person go first." And mom said, "That's right." She took the pancake, put it on the plate. The older brother said, "You can be Jesus today. I'll take that one." It's learned. It takes time to be like Jesus, and it's an effort. It truly is, to be a Christian, a lifelong marathon. It's a journey. It's not learned in a day. We do change. We go from being darkness to being light, but change takes time and effort to walk and act like Jesus. Our text this morning speaks to us being different than the world that we live in. Just previous to this, Jesus said, you are to be the salt that's in this world. You are to be light. It calls us to be God's people in this world. It calls us to stick out, to be different. These verses have to do with following Jesus and being different. It calls us to be abnormal, if you would. That young lady at the end of the video said, this is not our home. The Bible relates it, said this, we are aliens and strangers here. An alien is not where they belong. They're somewhere else they belong. And to be strange is what we've been called to do in this world. It's to define our lives, to live to a higher standard. And our ultimate goal, according to this text, and our ultimate goal as Christians, is to glorify God and please Him above everything else. That's what it's all about, shining the light of Jesus in our world. Now, in Jesus, we see that this light is revealed in who He was, because He was the light. Way back in Genesis chapter 1, it said, in the beginning, God created. And God said, let there be light, and there was light, and God saw the light was good, and He separated light from the darkness, and God called the light day. So light entered creation. And then later in the book of John, chapter 1, look with me there. John picks up on that same idea there, and he relates it very well to who Christ is. And probably some of you have this section of Scripture memorized, but it's beautifully written. In the beginning, the Word already existed, Jesus. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God, and God created everything through Him, and nothing was created except through Him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and His life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot extinguish it. God sent a man, John the Baptist, to tell about the light, so that everyone might believe because of his testimony. John himself was not the light. He was simply a witness to tell about the light, the one who is the true light and gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. As you read on in verse 14, it said, the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. The light came into the world. Just like in the beginning of creation, God spoke it into being, Jesus came. It's kind of interesting. John, the writer of this gospel, is introducing John as the forerunner, John the Baptist, as the forerunner for Jesus, to introduce Him as He goes ahead of Him. Hey, He's coming into the world. Be prepared, is what He's telling us. And it's really kind of fascinating. To a Jew, the Day of Atonement was an incredibly important day. Now, the Day of Atonement was set aside, ordered in the Old Testament by God Himself in the law, that what we are to do, or what the nation of Israel is to do, is a high priest goes into that very holy place, and the sins of the nation are rolled forward or set aside for another year as they go in and they abide for the sins of the nation by the slaughter of a lamb. But what's kind of interesting, we don't get from Scripture, but more from history, it's kind of interesting. On the Day of Atonement, it being such a special day for the Jews, there's a watchman put on the wall of Jerusalem. And as the sun rose that morning, that watchman would proclaim loudly to the city, I see the light! I see the light! And that's exactly what John the Baptist did. He stood in the Jordan River as Jesus went by, and he said, I see the light, it's Him, the Lamb that has come into the world. And you see, that's exactly what we understand Jesus to be. He is the light. Jesus will later testify, He said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows Me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Church, if we're in Christ, we are the light of the world. We reflect the gradients of God's glory, and we are a reflection of Jesus as we live. The Apostle Paul would later write this, "For God, who said, 'Let the light shine in the darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ." Now, we know that God brought light into the world. Jesus has come into the world, but there's a problem. Mankind, us, we have rejected the light. That's what it says in Scripture. John chapter 3, verse 19, just after the section I read out of John chapter 1. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men love darkness instead of light because of their evil deeds. So we would rather gravitate towards darkness. Jesus said about this darkness that we love it. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear of his deeds to be exposed. And also, it says in the Gospel of John, Jesus came to that which was his own, and they rejected him or did not receive him. That's talking about the Jews. And the ultimate end of that quest was Jesus' crucifixion and eventual resurrection. He defeated death and the recognition that he is the light. So we recognize that God has come into the world, Christ has come into the world to help us understand we are in need of light, every single one of us. Paul says it this way to Timothy, "God, the blessed and only ruler of the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone is immortal, who lives in unapproachable light, whom no one can see or be seen, to him be honor and might forever." So God will not be in the presence of darkness or sin. That's part of the problem. John said, if we claim to have fellowship with him, yet walk in darkness, we lie, and the truth is not in us. So our key is to be in fellowship with the one that is the light, so that we might shine that light in the darkness and change our lives. Christians are called upon to reflect the light of Christ. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, we just read, it said, "You, church, me, are the light of the world." We bear his light. And in fact, if we follow Jesus, we will be light. This coming week, we're going to get a chance to shine Jesus' light like you wouldn't believe. There's been hours already to get prepared for the week, whether it be through the teachers or through the decoration of the set. Taylor's worked hard this past week. Olivia's worked hard. Ginger's been here quite a bit. I know Robert, Lily, he worked with the set as well. There may be some others that have been in out of the building that have been working all week long. And if I left you out, I'm sorry. But there's been hours already working towards the week. And here's what I find so amazing. We have a community in Ironton and the surrounding area, but the bulk come from Ironton. We get a chance to talk about Jesus all week long. I'm excited about the lessons I'm getting ready to teach. I get to do the elementary age children, and I always look forward to it. Now, I'm going to tell you, I dread it before it gets here, but once it gets going, it's like a roller coaster. You just hang on. It really is. But here are parents that won't attend church or grandparents that don't attend church, but you know what? They'll bring them to the church and let them teach us about Jesus and feed them some cheese puffs and Stellar Star Crunchers and whatever else they come up with. But we get an opportunity to do that. And I get excited every year for Vacation Bible School because I'm always amazed that people allowing us to talk about Jesus the way we do. And not only that, but those that are working, whether it's going to be, we have a ton of teenagers that are helping this year. They're going to be shining the light of Jesus in kindness. We have a lot of our adults that are going to be involved with our preschoolers. And church, I'm going to tell you, working with preschoolers is tough stuff. It's work. And I credit any teacher that teaches with kudos because that's stressful. But those that work with preschoolers deserve an extra bit of attention to me. That's just my opinion. But we're going to get a chance to shine Jesus's light like you wouldn't believe this week. And we're going to do our best to do that. You, church, are the light of the world. And we get a chance to do something special this week. There's a young boy that got an opportunity to travel with his parents to Europe. As they were traveling around Europe, they went to some of the beautiful cathedrals that are just dotted all along the countryside in that area of the world and different even places, these beautiful cathedrals with the stained glass windows like we've got covered up today, but we have them. The little boy just admired every cathedral that he went into and was always amazed at that stained glass window. When he finally got back to the United States, he had gone to Sunday school one morning, and his Sunday school teacher said, "What is it that you like so much about when you were traveling?" He said, "I love going into the cathedrals and seeing all the architecture that was there." He said, "But not only that, but," he said, "I love the stained glass windows." And she said, "Well, what was so impressive about the stained glass windows?" He said, "Because you got to see all these saints of God like Paul and Peter and the apostles." And he said, "And the light shined through them and they illuminated everything." Isn't that what we're supposed to be, church? The light of Jesus that shines through us illuminates all that is around us in a very dark and sad world. That's what we've been called to be. I don't think we'll sing this song this week because it's old, but I remember it and I'm not going to sing it to you. I'm just going to read it to you. "This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine, let it shine, let it shine." Church, that's what we've been called to do, to shine the light of Jesus in a very dark world. Let's pray. God in heaven, I thank you for the opportunity we have this coming week. I pray that you will be glorified in every action, whether it be the working out of crafts or the feeding of a snack, the teaching of a lesson, the kind acts that we offer to the children, Father, that we can share that light that's within us, that we might glorify you and that we might be excited about what you've done in our individual lives. I pray, Father, as we move into a time of decision, that you'll bless it, that you'll guide our lives, that we be different than the world that we're surrounded by. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with me this morning, please? If you're here this morning and you're not in Christ, I invite you to come forward and make that decision to follow him wholeheartedly. If you need to be baptized into his name, you can come forward and do that. Or if you have another decision to make, what a great day to do that. Let's sing together.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Decide now to follow Jesus. Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? No turning back.
Please be seated.
How great Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise. My heart will sing how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great, how great is our
In Romans chapter 3, the Bible says in verse 10, there is no one righteous, not even one. And then in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, the Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. This is the plight of all people. This is the shadow that hangs over our existence. But our Heavenly Father steps in and gives us the opportunity to be saved, redeemed, and forgiven. Listen to Romans chapter 3, starting with verse 24. And we are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in His blood. The wrath of God that every one of us deserve has been thwarted, has been diverted, because God, in His mercy and His grace, offers Jesus Christ to cover our sins and allow us the opportunity to be forgiven, to be redeemed, and to be saved. And so this is the time when we remember and show appreciation to God the Father for this wonderful gift that we've been given, which is Jesus Christ the Lord, sacrificed for all of us. And so we remember Him at this time by taking this bread and drinking this cup to remember His body and His blood. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we're so thankful that Your grace is so deep, that Your love is so very, so rich in our lives. We thank You, Father, for this wonderful gift of Jesus Christ the Lord, that we could look to Him and believe in Him and have our sins be forgiven. And so we thank You now, Father, for this opportunity to remember Your one and only Son and what He did for us. Thank You for this bread and for this cup. And thank You for the wonderful sacrifice of our Lord. And through Him we pray. Amen.
you would, please stand. Just a couple of things. I know not everybody can participate in Vacation Bible School because of work and different things of that nature. Do me a favor, pray for it this week. Pray that Christ is impacted upon other people's hearts this week. It'd be a good opportunity for you to be involved in that ministry. Just a couple of quick mentions. If you have a baby bottle for Two Hearts Pregnancy Center, if you want to return that, you can. You can even return it this week. We'll drop those off. A couple of mentions. Karen Osborne is still at Ohio State. Remember her in your prayers. She will have another test this coming week to see if where everything is, if she's healing up well. Remember her and Sean and their family. And also, Bill Goslin is now at Cleveland Clinic. He'll be having surgery to repair his bowels here coming up very soon. So I know he'd appreciate our prayers as well. So let's pray before we depart this morning. Father God, we thank you that you hear us, that you love us. We ask your blessing on our week. We pray for Bill, that you be with him and Billy as he's away from home and that he gets the good care he needs. And we also pray for Karen and Sean as well, that you be with them and their family. Thank you, Father, for all the things that we could recognize you for. Ask your blessing on our week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine.